This is Sheila Bender, and you are listening to In Conversation, Discussions on Writing and the Writing Life. Today we have with us Christina Baldwin. She's a Whidbey Island writer and teacher whose work is embedded in community making and story catching. She is co-founder with Anne Linnea of Peer Spirit, Inc., and the Circle Way Process, bringing modern structure and application to the human heritage of Circle. Christina is the author of 7 books, including, with Anne, The Circle Way, A Leader in Every Chair, Story Catcher, Life's Companion, Calling the Circle, and The 7 Whispers, Spiritual Practice for Times Like These. Now, in her vibrant 70s, she is focusing on the legacy of her story work, teaching her autobiographical writing seminar, The Self as the Source of the Story, working on a novel, and supporting the role of story to guide us through troubling times. Welcome to the program, Christina.
It's a delight to be here.
I'm glad to be talking with you after years of knowing about you and your work. And you certainly are in your vibrant 70s with all those projects aboard and your teaching. So we'll get into all of that. But I wonder if we could start by talking about how you came to all of this, your beginnings with the practice of journaling and moving into the work that you do today.
Well, I think I have a point that I knew about at the time. I was inspired by Anne Frank. Her diary was required reading in 8th grade English all across America. I think perhaps it still is. I was, oh my goodness, a girl has a voice. A girl could get to the page. Mm-hmm. And this was 1960. This was not such a common thought. So I got an old school notebook and I drilled a hole in it to lock it up from all of my secrets and began writing about almost nothing. But it was very important to me, and it broke open this sense of having a voice. And that was one thing I knew. And I think as I look back on it years later, I realized also that I felt like a child that no one was paying that much attention to. And so it became imperative for me to begin to pay attention to myself. And that was a huge sort of spontaneous awareness that I think has influenced the work I've done forever, which is we need to be in charge of our life story and we need to pay attention to ourselves and kind of drive our own vehicle of life.
When you were doing this journaling, did you say high school?
Yeah, ninth grade.
Were you doing it privately? Were you talking to others about it? Did you know that any other girls were journaling?
We got oftentimes those little 5-year diaries from mm-hmm. the drugstore that had 4 lines to write down something about a day. Uh-huh. And so I ended up writing things like what I wore to school and that what we had for dinner, because it was all the space that was there, and that was immensely boring.
Mm-hmm.
So pretty soon they just got chucked in the bottom of the underwear drawer. No one else that I knew was taking Anne Frank's inspiration and doing it themselves. So it kind of drove me into a sense of secrecy almost. Mm-hmm. And then in 10th grade, we read Lewis and Clark's journals, and I thought, oh my God, they're writing for the President of the United States. It became a very private thing, and when I was 24 and out of college, I went to the University of Minnesota Extension Programs, and I said, I've been secretly doing this for 10 years. Do you have any courses on this that I could take? And they said, 10 years, you're the teacher.
Of course.
So that's how I got into becoming a journal writing teacher. And they put out, I wrote up a little class description, and 12 people came. And I just kind of stumbled into the awareness that other people were doing this, that other people were also interested in it, and we just became co-teachers for one another. And it really was also the seed of the circle, because I walked in and I set my little teaching notes down on a lectern and everybody's lined up in rows, and I said, oh no, this isn't going to work. So we just moved the desks into a circle and began saying, why do you do this? What's intriguing to you? All of that kind of thing. And pretty soon we began developing the understanding intuitively that sitting together in a circular shape and kind of putting our common interest in the middle, which in this case was, why are we doing this weird secret behavior of journal writing? It creates a whole different learning field. That's how I began braiding those two aspects of my life together, is that the circle is space for story.
And your first book was?
My first book was One to One, Self-Understanding Through Journal Writing.
Uh-huh.
And it was so pioneering at that time, they had to create a new category in the Library of Congress for it, because nobody had been writing about personal writing, therapeutic uses thereof. And I was 30 years old, so it was really an interesting and wild time to kind of set this movement in place.
Yes, that title that you, well, the phrase you just used, is that the category that the Library of Congress made?
Yeah.
And now it's probably much fuller than it was.
Oh my goodness, yes, probably 1,000 titles.
How does that feel to you to have started a movement?
Humbling and exciting. I think when you're 30, you don't think about it as starting a movement. I mean, I'm just trying to keep myself going. I was a little freelance writer living in Minnesota, getting paid $50 an article or something, and it grew. It just kept growing and growing, and as more and more people kind of came forward, and it particularly it was dovetailed with the feminist movement and the rise of women and women saying, I do have a voice, how do I explore that voice? The first 10 years that I taught, trying to give women space to speak in which they would not be judged and to get over their self-judgment, that was the main theme. And we never read to each other in class because I wanted them to have that sense of you actually have a boundary. And a lot of women came with horror stories of their husbands finding their journals or their children and having themselves ridiculed. And so this creation of privacy and boundary was a huge theme in the 70s and into the 80s. And then it's like we got our feet under ourselves and other books were coming out and more, and there was a journal writing conference and all of this kind of thing. And I wrote another book, which really is my best known book about journal writing, called Life's Companion, Journal Writing, a Spiritual Practice. And that book really took off.
And that book is still available.
Yes.
Well, you talk about the growth of the movement and you've grown too, and more into the power of circle. And you have a partner now in the writing and in the work, Anne Linnea. And how did you two get together to do this work? And how does it work?
Well, we met in my writing class. We met at Self as the Source of the Story. And as we were sitting there, my book, Life's Companion, had just come out. And so I had been invited to teach this week-long seminar at the University of Minnesota in Duluth. And so I was up there teaching it. She took the second year that I offered that class, and she came to me after the first day and said, you know, I'm an environmental activist, and I do a lot of work around here with people who are burning out because we're so focused on saving the planet and nature, and very few people have an interior life. So when they're not being activists, they don't know where to go to get replenished. And I said, well, I'm working with all these women that are having an interior life and self-discovery, and I want to get them out in the world doing something. So we created a weekend seminar called Women and the Planet, Returning the Gift, to bring those two groups into an intersection in which the activists could take a breath and really attach to their own sense of wonder, some sense of self-defined spirituality. You know, how do you source yourself for the long haul? And then to also bring the journal writing women into, I got to get out and do something. And it was very successful. And that led us into, in the early 90s, a deeper exploration of why does the circle work? Why does this shape do what it's doing? And there was no internet yet. There was no Google circle and see who else is studying this. It was a highly intuitive process, putting together what we came to call the lightest possible structure for holding people into this, a sphere that is teaching us while we're in the middle of working in dialogue with one another.
And now you're continuing this kind of work through retreats on Whidbey Island, right?
What Anne and I are doing now, because she's 70 and I'm 73, is we've actually passed along the Circle Way work to the next generation of teachers. And that was a big chunk of the end of our 60s and my early 70s, is making sure we had teachers in place and practitioners, because we traveled. I mean, we've traveled to Africa and Europe and Australia and New Zealand and Mexico and Canada. And it's like, we're done with that. Like, could we just rest now? But we had these teachers in place. So now people who are interested in this work can go to thecircleway.net and find colleagues and resources. We just handed every resource we had into this nonprofit, which is very exciting.
Yes.
Because that was a movement we started. And when you're ready to pass it off, you need to have somebody to catch it. So
yes.
We have set that up. And so what we've returned to now is Anne is once again doing a lot of environmental activism in the Salish Sea area here. And I'm focusing on writing and story and working with people to really understand the necessity of holding on to our story when we're living through this kind of chaos.
So I know that you've prepared a bit of one of your books to read to us. Is it on that topic?
Yes. There are two things I want to read. This from Storycatcher. This is actually the opening page of Storycatcher. Life hangs on a narrative thread. This thread is a braid of stories that inform us about who we are and where we come from and where we might go. The thread is slender but strong. We trust it to hold us and allow us to swing over the edge of the known into the future we dream in words. It is story, the abundance of it and the lack of it, that shapes us. Story, the abundance of it and the lack of us, that gives us place, lineage, history, a sense of self. Story, the abundance of it or the lack of it, that breaks us into pieces, shatters our understanding, and gives it back over and over again, the story different every time. Story, the abundance of it and the lack of it, connects us with the world and outlines our relationship with everything. When the power of story comes into the room, an alchemical reaction occurs that is unique to our kind. Love or hate, identification or isolation, war or peace, good or evil, can be stirred in us by words alone. The power of story is understood by the powerful, yet the power of story belongs to us all, especially the least powerful. History is what scholars and conquerors say happened. Story is what it was like to live on the ground.
You are listening to In Conversation, Discussions on Writing and the Writing Life with Sheila Bender on KPTZ 91.9 FM, Port Townsend. Today, Sheila is talking with Christina Baldwin about her career from teaching and writing about journalism to work on the power of circles to her new work of novel writing.
Can you talk a little bit about abundance and lack of it, that both those attributes are what push us forward?
What
shapes
us, yeah. So there are people who say, I know nothing. My parents never talked about their parents. I don't know where I come from. There are people who are adopted, people who are refugees, etc. And there's a lack of story that really shapes how they stand in themselves. And then there are people who are just sort of in this overwhelming stream of story. There's a friend of mine who wrote a memoir called Pieces of Eight about growing up in this large Italian Catholic family and how there was so much story going on that figuring out how to take place and identify yourself in the midst of that was equally challenging as silence. There is this looking for a balance of where am I in the midst of my life circumstances? How do I create a permeable boundary so that I am who I am, and I'm constantly receiving feedback and interaction.
Wow. I love what you said about the story of the powerful and the historians is the story of what happened. But the story that individual people have to write is what it was to live through those times.
Yeah.
And of course, we're listening to ourselves, I hope, during these times in our country and in the world. Before we talk more about that, I'd love for you to read the second excerpt that you have.
It's from the end of the book.
Okay.
But also fits into the story of these times. Story has a will to survive that seems almost independent of the storyteller, as though it has a life of its own. Oral story is a singing bird. When we let it out of the cage of the mind, it loves freedom. The song of the self will light on our shoulder as long as we don't try to capture it. Then it will flutter away and fly places we cannot imagine. It will nest and mate and raise other versions of itself that take on the color and hue and dialect of new territory. And some spring morning, when we most need to hear it, our story will return outside our window and sing us back into ourselves.
Beautiful and very lyric writing. It makes me want to leave the studio right now and start writing.
Oral story does that. I mean, I tell you a story, and if it catches in your mind, I mean, we're told stories all the time, and I don't know what your neurology is like, but for me, 80% of them have to go to make room for the next, right?
Uh-huh.
But there are some stories that people have told me or that I have told others that are 20, 30, 40 years old, and they're never gone.
Mm-hmm.
They have some kind of anchoring. And yet when they come back round to me, I mean, somebody will say, you know, I was in your class 20 years ago, and you said da-da-da-da, and I'll go, really?
Yes.
No, I don't remember that,
uh-huh.
Or I don't remember it that way, or there's some significant little thing I notice that I go, oh, that got changed. The gender got changed. The locale got changed. It's morphed out there.
Uh-huh.
But the thing is, it's living.
Right. Change is life. That is such a wonderful story about people coming and telling you what you said that mattered so much to them and the changes you can feel or not remember. I want to turn just for a moment about, with the growth of the journaling movement and the value being put on it for therapeutic purposes in medicine and grief work, there are also perhaps some things you're seeing or noting that are a little alarming. And I'm wondering if you might have any of those moments with what's going on in the world of journaling as it merges into the mainstream.
Boy, that is a complex question, because this whole idea of personal writing has just, it's like pouring water onto sand. It has just gone so many places in the course of my relationship to it. One thing I want to focus on is that journal writing is basically narrative, in that it has a beginning, a middle, and an end. Things happen to characters. They happen in place. Certain events are discussed. In private journal writing, events are not only discussed, but they're oftentimes ruminated on, sometimes for years, in an attempt to extract meaning out of them. And it is that kind of personal dive. I think of it as diving into the wellspring, paddling up your inner river. Where are you going? But it's a very private voice to the self. I think of it as therapeutic, based on the Greek word therapeutikos, which means to midwife a birth. And I've always loved that that's the source of the word. Therapy is to be the midwife. And so journal writing to me is an ability to midwife your own birth, to come into your own full adult self. So it's incredibly empowering. I don't think there are very many therapists who like say, and I want to read your journal, because 80% of it is irrelevant. It's when you get to the insight, when you have the aha, when you have been boring down and boring yourself with how many times am I going to go over this, and all of a sudden something comes that gives you that meaning. And for me, I've oftentimes burst into tears or burst out laughing and gone, oh, that's it. I finally got to the nugget. That's the thing then that is helpful if you're in a therapeutic talking relationship, is to go, I got it. Here's the nugget. In medicine, I think it's really being profound what's happening right now. There's a whole study of narrative medicine coming out of Columbia University in New York, because we realize that the body and the story are connected. And I have seen amazing things happen around that. One time, a woman in one of my courses said, this is the place I feel safe enough to write about an abusive moment in my childhood. I just wrapped her up in a blanket. I said, this is not a therapy session. If you want to go in there, wrap yourself up in safety. We're all going to keep writing. Is that enough support? Yes, everything was seemed to be set in place. And so she's over there, and she's having emotion. She's crying, but she's quietly crying as she's writing, really, a letter to her child self, talking about how she has survived this moment. And all of a sudden, on the side of her cheek, I can see a red fingerprint of a big hand. I mean, the fingers, like if somebody slapped you right now and your cheek just reddened right up. And it's appearing on her cheek because she's so into that moment. And then it flushes through. The amount of healing that comes out of that, but that was a time I thought the body and the story are absolutely interconnected and linked.
Yes.
And just as we're getting into a neurological understanding of how profoundly healing this story work is, it's also being shattered in a lot of ways by going into a texting, tweeting world.
Can you address that? How does texting and tweeting shatter the
Because
moment?
It removes the narrative. It's like, blink, mm-hmm. but where did that come from?
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm so pissed, da-da, and you're done. Or, I love so-and-so, or I love that song, but it's like, where did that come from? Where is the meaning source of that? Because it's completely decontextualized. It's like verbal debris. You know, we talk about those floating gyres of plastic out in the middle of the Pacific, and a lot of the tweeting, texting world to me is that. It's just pieces of plastic that look like they have comprehension, but they're just little bits of broken up nothing.
Oh, it's very, very dynamic description, but it does speak to the difference between the public world and the private world. That
absolutely,
in the public mm-hmm. world of tweeting, there's the superficial stuff without the story behind it, the narrative, without insight necessarily, just reporting for the moment, the moment's report.
Mm-hmm.
Well, thank you.
And this idea that that's important, and I see this. I'm not a tweeter. I'm resisting. But I see it on Instagram, I see it on Facebook, I see it in texting, particularly with some of the younger members of my family. And I'm going, okay, so you're having an ice cream cone, that's really sweet. Is there anything else you might want to share? You know?
And do you...
Or here's a picture of my breakfast. Great, honey. Is this to reassure your auntie that you're actually having an egg every now and then, or... But it is an attempt to communicate, to stay in touch. You know, so I'm not completely wanting to disrespect that because I believe it is an attempt to find connection, but it is shortcutting the work of it.
Right. There's really not a lot of intimacy in showing a picture of your breakfast.
No.
It's done for public consumption, not for the building of connection in an intimate way, I think.
Well, it's done to get a like. It's done to get response.
Right.
I mean, it's done to get response. And I think the urge for call and response mm-hmm. is huge. It's part of our hardwired nature. If I go, hello. I'm hoping to hear hello.
Well, do you think there's room in this world for both the private one-on-one or circle group that's really encouraging the reflection and the boundary making and the voice making and this mm-hmm. other kind of hey, how are you kind of clutter?
Well, absolutely, that's how I live. I mean, I live in both worlds. I live at both levels. My hope as I work with my grandchildren, as I work with my nieces and nephews, who are all in very busy stages of their lives, young career, the nieces and nephews are in young career, et cetera, or young families. I know they don't have time to sit down and reflect. Mm-hmm. But I'm hoping that they know that that attachment is possible.
Me too. Me too. And before we have to end the program, we could go on and on. It would be wonderful to talk longer. Tell us a little bit about the work you're doing now in terms of writing your books. You've mentioned that that's where your attention is instead of traveling around the world. What work are you doing for the future?
When I turned 70, I decided I wanted to give myself a new task in the area of writing, something that would be pleasurable to me, but would make me learn something, put me in the student position, not just always being in the retreat facilitator teacher position. And so I had this idea for a novel that just kept bugging at me and wouldn't go away. And I said, okay, I'm really going to dedicate myself to this. And it has been basically a delight in terms of having that excitement of being in the student position and learning something. It's not like going and studying chemistry, which would completely overwhelm me because I know nothing about it, but to stand in my body of work, but to tweak it into my own learning curve. And I highly recommend that for people, especially at that moment of, quote, retiring from something, is what do you know that's related to what you've been doing that you would really like to explore?
That sounds exciting. So I think that you're in a beautiful part of the world there on Whidbey to burrow in and write that novel. And I want to remind our listeners before we end that if they go to Peer Spirit, that's PEERSPIRIT.com, they'll be able to find out about the work you've done, the work you're doing, your books, your retreats on Whidbey. Anything else that would be there?
It is a sense of the life work for both Anne and me.
Uh-huh.
And our blogs. I really love writing my blog. I've written a lot about the writing process in there, about what I've been learning working on the novel. I've got essays on cursive or cursor and, you know, just a lot of fun stuff.
So. That sounds excellent. So besides running home to write, I need to run home and read your blog as well. Really looking forward to it. I want to thank you so very much for sharing the story of how your career developed, where it came from, and what you're doing today. Again, thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you, Sheila.
In Conversation is produced by Sheila Bender and edited by Charlie Fleischman.